I'm not racist, because I have had students from every nationality on this planet. On this planet, bar none. So we can't say that. But I have seen the black man in the martial art do some fantastic things. When he's in Cuba, when he's in Panama, whether he's in South Africa, in every place that you see the black martial artists, Jamaica, Barbados, every place, Trinidad, Don Jacobs in Trinidad, Obama over in Africa. It's mind-boggling of how this emerges. There's nothing that I'm saying, there's no label I'm putting on anybody. It's what it is. I can't change it, and nobody in here can change that. So rating is something that, beauty in the eye of the beholder. Rating and this and that. There's only one rating that counts, whether you can fight or you can't fight. Whether you're going to win or whether you're going to lose. For me, that's the only thing that counts.
Yes.
Hope I answered your question, sir.
Thank you. That's right. Anybody have any more questions? Any more questions? I got one right here. Okay. Well, for like.
Okay, I'll talk to you later. Thank you.
Yeah, peace, Master Duncan. I would like to know, as a former Crip Superior, I know how the opposition comes when...
I didn't hear the word that you utilized.
As a former gang leader, I was in the Crips.
Okay, I got you.
Yes, as a former Crip Superior, and all other aspects in life, joining conscious communities, I tend to find there's a lot of oppression and resistance amongst your own when you rise or find your way in the upper echelon. So I want to ask you, I'm pretty sure you've been encountered or met with a great deal of resistance from other so-called clans.
Oh, yeah.
And things of that nature. So I would like you to share, if you can, some of what you have encountered, because I'm pretty sure you've been G-checked, or I'm pretty sure someone tried to pull your whole card or test you tribes.
Yeah, many times, many times. And you know, as far as, you know, this hierarchy of people dominating people and fighting and killing for leadership and all that, to me that's a sense of cowardice and insecurity. You know, this is a way of actually reaching so deep to disprove a factual truth, which is cowardice and weakness. So this is something that happens, I don't know if it's gang or whatever gang activities or whatever it happens to be, there's a form of brotherhood and fraternity. And there's an hierarchy you have to follow. If that's utilized with honor and integrity and with brotherly love, you know, there's nothing wrong with that. But if it's going to be to break you psychologically, take your manhood away from you, dehumanize you, to make you less than human, then, you know, that's not what you need. And then again, with all the minds of the young gang and gangbangers out there, some of the greatest tacticians, you know, some of the greatest organizers, the greatest technicians. Because I remember when I was a recruit in the Marine Corps, when I went in, 56, with some guys who were like in the bishops and the quintos and chaplains from Brooklyn.
Right.
You see, that wearing busted to clean records so they could go to Paris Island. And some guys, and guys from Fort Greene, and some guys from Philadelphia. You know, the boppers and this and that. I was in a platoon of a bunch of thugs. So therefore, the Marine Corps found it easy to train these guys who already had a warriorship and possibly, you know, a leadership mentality. So, you know, when we turn against each other and all that, you gotta find a way to be, first of all, an individual. If you're not an individual, you can't be anything else. You know, because everybody's a leader. And if you follow, you should follow because it's going to serve your purposes or a common cause. But not to follow a set of principles that dehumanize you and make you into less of a man. Your manhood is what counts first. Everything else is secondary. You know, you can vacillate, you can theorize and utilize tactics because, you know, in our quest for some, you know, man's greatest enemy is fear. And you know, man's everyday concept of surviving are many. So you have to learn, man's greatest test is the ability to survive every day, survive what's coming, what's not coming. Unless you're an individual first, unless you believe in your own strength first, then the rest is not going to work too well for you. I hope I answered your question.
Oh, Sensei, has Hollywood ever approached you about doing any films in your career? If so, what were they, and if they reached your consideration, your serious consideration, or was there too much buffoonery for your taste?
Well, I tell you, I don't want to get into films and all of that, but I was involved at one point in the late 60s and also in the early 70s. I was involved in film projects. I was involved in one film in particular, which was called Ninja. And that was in 1970-71. It was going to be directed by Gordon Parks, my son David Parks, and written by Jack Sugrue. And at the time, my brother Dwayne Jones is now deceased. You know, from Night of the Living Dead, he's going to play a black CIA agent known as Joe Han. The Joe Han began to disrespect the system, and so therefore they start chasing him. So he comes his teacher. Before he became a CIA agent, he trained under the ninja. And the ninja was myself. So yes, that project took place, and it was never completed. But I consulted in a few films, but I have a lot of my works have been stolen from me. For example, you see the Bourne Identity, and the this, and the that, and the James Bond, they're using all of my techniques taken off of one DVD, and it's called Improvised Weaponry. So in other words, I'm being consulted in a lateral, oblique manner, but not directly.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Excuse me? It is available, but I didn't bring any today. But it's available. You know, when I did it in 1994, the producer said to me, look, Mr. Duncan, you did six of them already on Aikido Jiu-Jitsu and Ninjitsu. Let's do something, for those ladies in the elevators with shopping bags and all of that stuff that need to defend themselves. And 1994, this is now what, the year 2011? And it was picked up in Japan, of all places. In Japan and in Europe. So yes, I don't have any here with me, but I'll make sure you get a copy. I'll make sure and speak to Brother Simon and make sure that you get a copy. It's called the Oda Korosu. It's a Japanese word. Oda Korosu means the art of the naked kill. Meaning you use anything at your disposal to kill. Oh, look at that. Oh, get this. Oh, it's there. You see.
I'll take it. It's over here.
Wow. The Oda Korosu is a system that the Japanese call the scavenger art forms. Being such a culture and society based on proper, you've got to do everything proper. Like my Japanese teacher told me, everything has to be proper. The Oda Korosu were art forms that the nobility didn't want any parts of. So it was called the art of kakushi, or the scavenger art form. The Oda Korosu, the art of the naked killer. And I put it out there, and I to help a lot of people, and I'm sure it helped a lot of people. So now it's all over the world, all over the planet. The roll-up magazine for self-defense, a newspaper for self-defense, a lady's bracelet for self-defense, a ballpoint pen, a hardcover book, anything at all that you can put your hands on, any place, anytime. If you understand the human anatomy, the nerve centers, and human interaction, you can defend yourself and you can actually kill with it.
Yes, Mr. Duncan, I'm amazed at your spirituality, your total control of not having an ego, and I wish that I would be able to inspire my own self to be like that one day and to help others, because it's where we have to go. And
I'm just learning so much from you, just hearing you talk, and I'm glad you're giving a history, because we really need it, you know, people need to know their history. And without the ego, it's just a smooth sailing with the spirituality. I'm just amazed at this.
Thank you, sir.
That's right. Anybody have any more? You got another question for my brother here.
Peace. Duncan, and salute you on your many years of accomplishments, your many students.
Could you please stand up?
Yes, stand up.
Thank you.
You know, I salute you on your many years of accomplishments, your many students, and I'm just glad to be here. I have my children here. I wanted to bring them so they could experience this also. I just want to ask a brief question. Are you taking any new students, or what would someone need to do if they wanted to study under you?
Well, I have a very small studio. I am accepting students, but it's on a one-to-one basis. It's private, individualized training, and it leads to a rapid growth and rapid interaction of the technique. Yes, I do accept, but I'm on Long Island, and a lot of folks come out to Long Island from Brooklyn and elsewhere to train, from Philadelphia, from Jersey, and it's a long, long trip. But my son, Greg, he has a dojo in Jersey City, right at the end of the Allen Tunnel, and he has a lot of children there that he teaches. But as far as training, yes, I'll be happy to do the best to train, because you see something? You know, children are really the most important thing that we have, our most important, most valued commodity. And we have to be able to mold them from very, very young, because they can get away from us very, very young. So we have to be able to see that, and it's hard work. And it's hard work to put yourself in the mindset of a child, to make it work, but it's a worthy job.
Yes, it is.
And anything that I can do, I'll be glad to. Thank you, sir.
Well, Sensei, you spoke about some of your studism in the U.S.
Yes.
And as a Panamanian instructor, I'd like to know, or the truth be told, about some of your Panamanian instructors that you taught.
Some that I taught?
Yeah.
Well, there's one by the name of Adolfo Ennever. There was one named Ricardo Johns, and there was some other ones that went back. But they were training here in the States, that went back and they became doctors and other things. But the two main ones was Angie Ennever of AFMA and Ricardo John. Ricardo John, he became my student when he came to the States in 1970. And he was a great karateka to start with from before he left Panama. And he found my school down at Court Street, and he came to the dojo, became my student for a while, then he went into the army. So we still keep in contact. And Edinburgh. Some other Panamanians that I've trained, lots of them, they never wanted to be sensei. They just wanted to study the martial arts, you know, for themselves. But those are the two prominent ones that I know of.
Peace again, Master Duncan. I have a question about, I'm partially disabled, and I was wondering, I wanted to do something to strengthen myself. I have nerve damage, and I was wondering if that's ninjutsu is a proper form of training for that. Do you think that would help me?
Well, I think, you know, if you will study Tai Chi is a great, great form that allows you to intrinsically and spiritually garner your energy and garner your strength. Tai Chi is a good start where you can understand the dissemination of energy and of your intrinsic power, which the Japanese call Ki or Chi, and the Chinese call Chi, and that will be a good start. And as you progress, you may want to learn self-defense techniques. If you get into ninjutsu or judo or karate or anything else like that, understand that the ultimate result is to win if you have to fight physically. But there's a lot of things you have to follow. The history, the tradition, the machination leading up to it, to make you a total practitioner. But right now, you can practice any art form that's going to benefit you. Ninjitsu, not judo. Judo's pretty rough. You know, Aikido's pretty rough. A lot of throws and jujitsu's rough. But you know, you can do some soft Aiki techniques or some techniques utilized in the Tai Chi forms, because Tai Chi actually is a martial art form.
Yes.
If it's taught that way. So any martial art that you choose with ninjutsu or not, make sure that the instructor is going to pay attention to your needs. And let me say this, you know, I have a student right now, so blind, and he gets on the train from Manhattan, he comes out to West Babylon. I had another one who was totally blind, was a black belt, and he won a knife throwing competition.
Wow.
And then I had another kid came up to my annual up at West Point, a Storm King, and he's quadriplegic. And you know, when I went to South Africa, I had a chance to work with people who, you know, the kids, the parents said, well, we can't do anything with her or with him. And I saw we're able to get reaction. So, Your problems are, where that's concerned, are minimal. You can do anything you want to do, but do it with constraint and with intelligence. But make your conditions worse. Make sure that your teacher understands your needs. Hope I answered your question.
Hi, peace. My name is Aziza, and I recently started studying ninjutsu. And there are a lot of confusion and arguments as to what is real ninjutsu.
Who do you study ninjutsu with?
His name is Kevin Richardson.
Who?
Kevin Richardson.
Calvin Richardson.
Kevin Richardson.
Kevin Richardson, okay.
Yeah. So there's a lot of confusion and arguments as to what is real versus fake ninjutsu, and I was wondering if you could give a brief overview as to what is like genuine ninjutsu.
I'll be very happy to speak about this. One of my favorite topics. First of all, speaking ninjutsu is a Japanese word. So let's keep it within the Japanese realm. Ninjutsu is Japanese. It's not American, it's not African, it's not Chinese. And we speak about ninjutsu in Africa, they're called Yajigbetos. Those were the shadow warriors. Well, let's talk now about ninjutsu. Ninjutsu is a compendium of sciences and physical and tactical applications to bring about victory for yourself. Ninjutsu is the art of winning. It's the art of totality, the art of control, the art of understanding, the art of everything that's positive, the art of positivity. Now that's pretty hard to believe when you see people dressed in black throwing the shooter canes and the blowguns and the stars and cutting people down. That's largely myth. Now let me give you something. Ninjutsu has various different classes or ryus, supposedly. The most popular one was one called the Togagure or the Bujinkan. Then with the Bujinkan, you have an offshoot called the Genbukan. Then you have the Jinankan. These are all names given to these art forms by people. Now, ninjutsu has been around since the beginning of time. Now, I'm going to give you some history the way it was given to me by the Japanese masters. Ninjutsu was actually transported from India, a region called Kerala, from India into Tibet, into China, and then across the peninsula, the Korean peninsula, in the year 6 BC, into Japan. At the time, Japan was known as Chipango, not Japan, but Chipango, where people there's a lot of misconception what is and what is not. People began to use the art form, and by the way, ninjutsu is a form that's created for modern times. They were not called ninjas then. They were called shinobi, or shinobi waza, shinobi jutsu. And shinobi means the art of stealing in and stealing out. Because the ninjas, first of all, were utilized as spies, guerrillas, assassins, and espionage. That's what ninjutsu is all about. And as the years progress, it becomes glamorized. The black uniform that's utilized in ninjutsu really is not a uniform that's proven to be truth. That the uniform you see today was largely to make money. The black uniform, the uniform was utilized in the kabuki theaters, where people standing in full view dressed in black were ignored as if they didn't exist. but there were times combatively and tactically when to blend with the elements, to utilize the colors to blend with the elements. Now why blend with the element? For espionage, assassination, and to change the change power, to build nations, turn nations down, to collect information by which the warlords could empower themselves to gain history. So Japan was based on war and warfare, all kinds of wars. Throughout the Bible, there's been biblical wars and wars and warfare. The Bible says that one of the two oldest professions is espionage. So we go back a long time. So, I hope I answered your question, but it's a compendium of sciences that's broken down to strategies, tactics, and spirituality. The ninja practitioner, the shinobi warriors, as their text. Their text was the Sun Tzu, or the art of war. They utilized that to strategize, because they were strategists. Not only that, they were artisans, they were kabuki dancers, they were doctors, they were healers, they were everything. But they utilized their skills for the benefit of their loved ones, and for whoever paid them the highest. In other words, they were mercenaries, they could be guerrillas, and also terrorists. You're welcome.
And the women too, kunoichi.
Yes, and the women were called kunoichi because they serve and played a very important role, just as today in espionage, with the many intelligence agencies, some of the best and most effective agents are females. So back then, and as today, the kunoichi or the female ninja practitioner add a lot of value. So to be a ninja, it's sometimes funny, sometimes it's amusing that people who have never walked in the shadow of death, people who have never had to live it and go into the belly of the beast and survive, talk about being ninjas, but they're not. They're not. The only ninjas today that I know of operating is Army Special Forces, is the Navy Unity SEALs, Marine Corps Reconnaissance, all the specialized units who are utilizing legally those tactics to fight war. If somebody became tactically offensive utilizing the ninjutsu that you're supposed to learn, which nobody's teaching you anyway, they teach you how to use the sword, the stars, the dress in the black, you know, the kame and the postures, that is not enough. You gotta understand the history. You gotta understand the inception, you gotta understand what it means, you gotta understand the totality, what it really represents, where it came from, where it already evolved, and where it's going today, and where it's going into the future. It's bigger than just words. The art of invisibility. Nobody really disappears, nobody becomes invisible. But there is a concept of utilizing the elements to give the semblance that you have disappeared. But there's a lot of different steps of training. But ultimately, to be a ninja or shinobi practitioner is never to lose. It's the art of winning. Hope I answered your question.
Well, Sensei, many people practice martial science, practice martial arts, practice combatives. Would you be kind enough to speak to the legalities as we train to be proficient in our combatives and our sciences? Would you be kind enough to speak to the legalities that we will be responsible for?
Yeah, I'll be glad to, because, you know, I teach all my students the legalities of their action. You know, every action that you utilize, be it utilizing the straw, or utilizing the stem of your glasses, or utilizing the cane, or utilizing the camera, utilizing anything, if you use it effectively to injure or kill somebody with it, you've got to answer for it. But a lot of the weapons that we utilize, the hedge weapons, you know, the wind weapons, the weapons of distance, the chains and all of that, they're all outlawed. They're outlaw weapons, especially in New York State. You can't own a throwing star. I don't know why they're afraid of it, because most people can throw straight anyway. And nobody's going to carry a samurai sword, you know, the katana, the wakizashi, the odachi. Nobody's going to carry those. People are going to utilize modern-day technology to enhance their ninja training. And the ninja's greatest mind is the greatest weapon is the mind. The ninja can be visible or invisible with his mind or her mind. At its worst, the ninjitsu is the most devastating compendium of sciences you can ever learn. Devastating. Really devastating. Without equal. We can utilize the space technology and modern warfare with all of these missiles and all of that military tactics. Same principle, same tactics. Tactics and strategies and implementation. And decisiveness.
How does the law define the moment that we change from being the attacked to us becoming the attacker? Meaning, when will we be responsible for the overkill, when we neutralize
the
predator?
Say, for example, one of you is walking down the street. You walk out of here right now, and somebody attacks you. And say, for example, Master Jackie, somebody attacks you, and it's known that you are a high-ranked sensei, and you're a karateka, and you block that person to kick him, knock him down, and he's incapacitated, you back off. Because if you go any further, then you're the attacker. You send him with a knife. Somebody attacks you with a knife, you disarm that person, and the person incapacitated, you'll take the knife and stab them with it, because then you're the attacker. The law look at technicalities. The law look at things differently. Unless it's a dark alley someplace where somebody attack you and you take them out and disappear and nobody knows anything, but then DNA may catch up with you. So you have to be careful how you execute these techniques. But it's difficult to tell people who are afraid for their lives. You know, you can't tell them, well, you know, somebody attacks you and you got a knife in your hand, just cut his pinky. You better cut anybody's pinky. You're gonna cut them someplace, you're gonna bleed. If somebody attacks you with a gun, and you take the gun away from them without the round going off, and hear the battle, that person gets shot. You know, it has to be up to the judges, and you know, I used to do a lot of competitive shooting. I shot for a long time, with pistol competitively, and there's an old saying, I'd rather be judged by 12 than carried by 6. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I can't sit up and tell people what you can or shouldn't do. Because, you know, if I stepped out here right now and somebody tried to hurt me, you know, I'm not a kid anymore. I know I got to utilize maximum efficiency against their weakest point to survive. The only thing is survival. And if you stop to think, well, you know, you attack me, and the judge is going to worry about it. By the time you finish thinking about that, you'll be in the hospital or dead. You have to react and respond at the moment. That's why you spend all these years drudgery, reading books, going to dojos, breaking bricks, fighting, winning tournaments, this and that, just like a shooter. Shooter goes to the range and practices every day, wins a million trophies, and when it's come time to save his life, he chokes up. It has to work, be worth something. So you can't stop to think. If you stop to think what the judge is going to say or who saw you, you're going to be in problems. So it's called discernment. You discern and you react. Instinctively serve to protect yourself and your loved ones or somebody in need. Someone in need. You know, I tell my students, you can run, run. If you can avoid, avoid. Avoid it first. You can talk your way out of it. Avoid it. If you can get away with it, get in your car, drive off, run, run, run fast, you know, pretend that you're afraid and beg for your life, all of that is good. It doesn't work too well today. If you got to fight, don't lose. If you're going to run, run fast. Or stay off the street. So get out in society, stay home. Come out after dark.
Only in the light.
You come out after dark at night and they're waiting for you. You never know. So you gotta take control of yourself, your fears, your abilities, because you and yourself and your life belongs to you. And you have a right to defend yourself the best way you can.
That's right.
But it will start, no picking the fights now. Joe, slap somebody, now hit me, and you stab them. You know, it doesn't work that way.